Good morning, and hey now, PSW staff, clients, and friends joining us for a Thursday class. We're just going to kick it cool in LA before we see your film scoring results for In the Mood for Love, and you guys were definitely in the mood for love because we have some really, really nice special music to share with you tomorrow, so you guys did a great job. Hope you enjoyed Damn Yankees and weren't offended by the title. It's a lot of fun baseball musical. And then we looked at Darius Milhaud, the French composer, did all those great Brazilian tunes. So this is now, you know, since we'll get into LA, we'll rest a little bit because this is a great, this was a huge statement, this building, to the rest of the world, mostly to New York, but the rest of the world too, saying that LA, that we've made it as a real metropolis, as a real city. This iconic hotel was not just a hotel, but a statement saying that we as Angelenos, as Los Angeles, have arrived. Today we're going to be looking at the really historical, great, iconic place, the Biltmore Hotel. So the Biltmore Hotel opens in 1923, largest hotel west of Chicago at that time. So that's why it was like New Yorkers were like, well, where is there to go, you know, east of, you know, okay, we'll go to Chicago, but nowhere else. But they discovered, well, actually LA opened a huge new hotel that we can, you know, maybe we can go and stay at. So, you know, 20s and 30s, glamour is starting to come in. Early 1900s, you know, oil, movie companies are starting because of the weather. The weather is good here and the climate's good here, but we don't really get the glamour and opulence until about the 20s, and this is perfect time. So, you know, and downtown is where most of this is all going on. We've yet to go to Bullock's Wilshire, 1928. That's going west, but this is downtown, and this is right next to Pershing Square. We did a class on Pershing Square, if you remember. So we're just gonna have too much fun. So the name comes from the Vanderbilt family, the Biltmore Estate, which is in Asheville, North Carolina, built around 1889 to 1895. Still, you can still tour it there. It's the largest privately owned house in the United States. That's the Biltmore Estate. So, and that's still owned by them. But John Bauman, he was the founder of this hotel and he wanted the best. He had a lot of success with different hotels in Cuba and New York, and he really thought, well, LA is the place to do this great hotel. So it opens in 1923, in October, and over 3,000 people were in attendance for this thing. It's gone through so much history, and we'll kind of just, there's too many dates and facts, but I want to give you an overview of how beautiful this whole thing is. So it had about 1,000 rooms in it, and each had its own bathroom, which at that time was so unheard of, so to have your own bathroom. Now there's about 683 rooms because they've built, you know, bigger suites, and I mean, it's a huge, it takes about, you know, half a city block, this whole thing. So that was a big thing. So let's look at our timeline. This is the same exact year as the Hollywood signs erected. If we remember the Hollywood sign, Harry Chandler, that was a big way to advertise for real estate. You know, because that was flimsy material and was supposed to be torn down quickly. It was just an advertisement. Before this, though, there's some fun stuff happening in LA. The Hollywood Bowl is a few years earlier, in 1921. But the Bowl is kind of a random place in Hollywood, you know, field. You know, I mean, there's not much there. But that started. Watts Tower, Simon Rodia, he's doing that in 21, the same year as the Bowl, and the Ambassador Hotel. The Ambassador is probably the closest hotel that the Biltmore is very much like. They both did presidential political campaigns, and they both hosted the Academy Awards. So Ambassador is, although, you know, that closed, and now it's a school. Biltmore is still there. It's up and running, so this has a happy ending. So Bauman, you know, the guy hires architecture Schultz and Weaver. Well, they did a lot of stuff that was really cool. They did a few in LA that were really cool. They did the Jonathan Club the same year, which is still there, gorgeous building. They did Park La Brea about 10 years later in 1944. But they did some beautiful buildings in New York, the Waldorf in 1931, and then the Park Lane Hotel, which is my mom's favorite hotel in New York, just in case you were wondering. And then they hired John B. Smeraldi. He was hired to decorate and to create these beautiful frescoes and murals and marble fountains and columns. And he really brought elegance to this. Crystal chandeliers, cast bronze stairways and doorways. Just fine work. He also worked at the White House, did work at the White House and at the Vatican, so pretty good track record here. So as we're taking a look, I mean, just elegance, right? The chandeliers, the fixtures, the indoor pool. I love that indoor pool. So many great things. So a lot of these things were hand painted in 22 when it was being constructed by Smeraldi. And so there's so much, so much thought goes into these things. It's not just, let's just put up a building as fast as we can. There's a lot of thought. We did a whole class on prohibition and tunnels in LA, which I hope was not too scary for the kids. But, you know, as we know, liquor was outlawed for about 13 years in the United States, which of course doesn't mean nobody was drinking. They were probably drinking even more. Well, that's not true, actually. It actually, prohibition did help a lot of, cut down on a lot. But as we talked about, the problem was organized crime came in. So we talked about gangsters and tunnels in LA. So Biltmore was definitely one of the places. The Gold Room acted as a speakeasy. We've talked about speakeasies, hidden doors, and there's still a place that you can, the door is still there that connects to a room that has a wooden countertop, and we talked about this just for a little bit, and you can still, on the Olives side. So people were hanging out. There's a presidential suite there, very spacious, seen by 6 U.S. presidents and royalty, and also people like Bugsy Siegel and Al Capone were guests there. And this is where they had the first meeting about the Academy Awards. Isn't that funny? Like, they had to have a meeting before this ridiculous ceremony started. So it was a luncheon in 1927 with Louis B. Mayer to discuss, to discuss plans for actors, because the actor's salary was kind of pretty just standard rate. And then there was conversation and somebody sketched a design for the Oscar statue at this luncheon. And from this little sketch, the Academy Awards would start at the Roosevelt later. And it was then, and Louis B. Mayer kind of said, well, what more do these actors want? Do they want an award? And yeah, I guess if you give people awards, they show up and they do better work. So that's where it started from. And it hosted several Academy Awards. I mean, Clark Gable, Spencer Tracy, Jimmy Stewart, Gary Cooper, all these great actors, Betty Davis, Joan Fontaine, too many people to name. It was elegance. It was just sheer elegance. 1960, you get the National Democratic Convention, where LA chose John F. Kennedy for the presidential nominee. Scared to think that his brother would be assassinated just a few miles west of there, about, you know, 7-8 years later, 1968. And then we did a whole class on the Beatles in Los Angeles, and we talked about how there was so much, you know, media around the Beatles coming to America for the first time that they had to land on the roof of the Biltmore. Then it comes time to when we get to the part in the 70s. The 70s in LA, in the 80s, a lot of disrepair. And I was trying to think about was it drugs and, although drugs were going on, of course, before, but I don't know, or civic leaders, people that just kind of, all these, I think in the 70s and 80s, this kind of elegance was seen as kind of square. And so there's a lot of negligence probably to great buildings and parks that we've looked at, you know, with MacArthur Park we looked at. So, and I think in the 90s and then up until then, people became aware that there are treasures here in this city. And yes, we do have a little bit of history, even though it's not, you know, it's not Denmark or something like that. There's still a little bit of history here that we should, you know, hold on to and save. So it was very close to being shut down, but it was saved because obviously it's still there today. Just because, you know, I like the Black Dahlia, you know, history. This is where the last spotting of Elizabeth Short, who was the, you know, Black Dahlia. This was the last time she was seen. Biggest probably unsolved murder case ever, even though George Hodel did it, but that's just my opinion. But this, so, and then of course tons of movies, I mean too many, and TV shows. I mean, The Sting, movie, the film Ocean's 11, Chinatown, Bugsy, and then Mad Men. So, you know, it's used for filming all the time. So, elegance. I just wanted to share with you some one of my favorite hotels in the world. It's so fun. You can just walk through the lobby. There's the cognac room. There's a bar there. It's really lovely. It's so much fun. Big part of our LA history class. Big part of our LA history here. I think that's all I got. I mean, how much longer do you want? You know, go down and visit it. It's open. You can just walk through it. Okay. Miss you and love you. Hope you're, you know, enjoying these. And I will see you tomorrow with your film scoring results. Hey, now, for In the Mood for Love. Okay. See you tomorrow. Bye.